My name is Chris Wysopal. I'm the CTO and co-founder of Veracode. I just want to start by giving a little background of, you know, where did I come from to start a company. It was my first company I started in 2006. Before that, I was a security consultant, so I did services. And before that, I was an engineer, but I like to call myself a hacker hobbyist. In the 90s, I was part of a hacker group called Loft Heavy Industries. And we kind of started with this concept of vulnerability research and manual pen testing. And we didn't quite know how to make a business out of that. So my first job really in security was at a consulting company where all of us from the Loft joined and became their R&D team. And I learned from that, I learned how enterprises wanted to consume security services and what enterprise problems were. So as opposed to being an outsider, sort of just kind of hacking away and doing vulnerability research, I kind of was able to learn from that experience what enterprises wanted from security. And that helped form the ideas for Veracode, which really is automating application security testing, static analysis, dynamic analysis. And those ideas really came out of seeing the problem that without automation, you know, there wasn't enough people, it was too slow, it was too time consuming, it was too expensive. And this was an area that had to be highly automated because we all know that this was even before Mark Andreessen said software is eating the world, that software was exploding even in 2006. So that's sort of where, you know, I came from to start Veracode.
Kristina Bergman. I'm the founder and CEO of Integris Software. We're a data privacy automation company. So everybody who's heard of GDPR and CCPA and the 30 other states in the US that have got privacy legislation on the floor, we're the company that helps you understand where your data is, what data you have, right down to the data element level using machine learning and natural language processing, and then tie it to business obligations. And those obligations could be regulations, those could be contractual obligations or your own internal policies. And then we have an eventing engine to trigger events to lead to workflows, to automate those workflows. So for instance, we see credit card coming in through a stream of data that doesn't meet encryption standards, we automate that action to encrypt it. So that's what we do. A little bit about my background. This is actually my third startup, but my first one in software. I started driving movie theaters and painting companies, and that's how I paid for business school, and then fell backwards into the software industry through a personal connection, and worked at Crystal Decisions. If any of you played with Crystal Reports from years ago, you may remember it. I worked on early versions of that. We got bought by Business Objects, and then before SAP bought Business Objects, I left and went to Microsoft, and ran the BI product management team there, and then SharePoint. And it was at that point that I got recruited over to a venture capital firm and got to spend about 4 years in the VC world. And that was incredibly interesting. The two companies that I had done before were self-funded, you know, saved up money, bought my own gear. This was my first exposure to fundraising and sitting on the other side of the table. And just being able to see the patterns of what emerged and the patterns behind why certain companies got invested in and why others didn't and what makes for a big multi-billion dollar exit versus not, that was really instructive to me from the perspective that I knew what to look for, but it also meant that, you know, when my feet got a little bit itchy and I wanted to become an entrepreneur again, I knew exactly what to look for in terms of the next thing I wanted to go do and what that criteria needed to be in order for me to, you know, leave my cushy job and go take the big ultimate risk of being an entrepreneur. So that's basically my background. And from there, I left and started Integris. And that was about a little over 3 years ago.
So next, we want to talk a little bit about sort of what's the founding story. Like, how did you actually do it? Because it seems like this is like a little bit mysterious. It's always different. I think luck plays a lot into it. You know, I can say I had no idea what I was doing. Fundraising and actually starting the company. You know, I knew how to, you know, have two or three people write some software and put it online. I had no idea how to build, get the funding to actually build a real company with a sales force, an HR department and something that could scale employees. And so my funding story is a little bit unique because we actually are, Veracode was a spin out of Symantec. The company I was at doing consulting called At Stake, we had incubated some technology, the static binary analysis technology, and we got bought by Symantec, and Symantec bought the whole company. So they bought the assets, they bought our patent that was pending on it, and they really didn't, we didn't fit into their business plan, right? They bought At Stake for our the consultants, not for the technology, and the technology didn't fit into their roadmap in any way. So they basically, you know, shut it down and laid us off. And we wanted to keep working on it. We thought there was a huge amount of value to the technology we created. So in order to start Veracode, we had to raise funds to actually buy out the technology and buy out the patent pending. And, you know, both of those things were problematic. You know, it's like they had a certain book value that they were depreciating that they wanted to get the money for. So like bootstrapping and just getting a small seed round really wasn't going to work because we both had to buy the technology and do that. So that led me down the VC path, which I didn't know anything about VC. We talked to about 18 VCs, and they're like, who are these two guys, these two hacker guys who've never started a company before? They don't seem to know what they're doing. And so that didn't go very well until we hit upon one VC where my co-founder, Christian Ryu, was a fraternity brother with from MIT. He was an entrepreneur in residence at this VC firm called Atlas at the time. And that personal connection was like, you know, he told the partners, you got to talk to these two guys. These are the smartest security guys you're ever going to know. They have no idea about business, so we're going to have to help them there. But that's where the luck factor comes in. That's where you have to like keep trying and trying and trying until you hit upon something like that. So, you know, that was a little bit non-standard to do a spin out like that. But the other key benefit of it, which I didn't really realize, was, you know, getting that founding team is pretty hard. Like if you have just yourself and maybe you find a co-founder, but like how do you get the next person, the next person, the next person? We were able to bring along six people that had already been working on this project and had already, you know, formed cohesively as a team and became sort of the kernel of the culture and, you know, sort of hit the ground running. So it was painful, but then I learned the lesson that like that founding group of people is super important to build your culture and get going fast. So there was some upsides and some downsides to it starting that way.
So Chris, I've got a follow-up question to that. I'm fascinated by the fact that you guys had the conviction to go and raise funds to go and buy this technology back. What was it that gave you that conviction? Like, was it a spidey sense? Was it market changes? What was it that gave you the conviction to say, okay, I'm going to go and put everything out there to go and try and raise money and go do this?
Well, I think we saw that there was a huge services business, consulting business with people doing code reviews and manual pen testing. And people are paying like $250 an hour for this very limited resource. So we saw that there was a big pent up demand. And we just thought that that was like the wrong way to do it. Mm-hmm. Like it's software, you should automate as much as you can. So we just really had this conviction that the market was kind of broken and it was going to change over time. Mm-hmm. And security testing was going to become a standard part of the development process. You know, it's mm-hmm. been slowly getting there. You know, it's been a long time, but I think that was the conviction that we were going to build a better way to do it.
That's awesome. I know we'll get to this later on what makes for a valuable startup, but it's pretty clear you had the spidey senses that said this is going to be a category creating company. This is going to happen.
So another aspect of the valuable startup was, you know, we didn't know what this thing called SaaS was. SaaS wasn't even defined yet. They called it on-demand software. And at the time, Salesforce, you know, this is like 2005, is calling it no software. And the VCs said, we'll only fund you if you do this with a SaaS model, because like part of our investment thesis is we have to invest in so many SaaS companies. And we said, yeah, I think we can figure out how to do that. And we didn't really understand the benefits of that, but that was a huge, huge differentiator to make a much more valuable company with the SaaS model.
That's awesome. Very cool. Well, my founding story is really born out of research. So years ago, I think it was 5 or 6 years ago, when the whole Edward Snowden thing came about, I remember watching the news and seeing how viscerally angry Angela Merkel was. And I thought, gosh, you know, she's usually pretty stone-faced. To get her riled and to get her visibly angry, they've clearly hit a nerve with this. And, you know, you think back in terms of European history, recent history, and it's not surprising that keeping things like race, religion, ethnicity, sexual orientation close to your vest and highly protected is all important for very obvious reasons. And so what I was watching was, you know, gosh, there's a lot of social backlash around this. And given that they've irritated government, that backlash is probably going to come in the form of regulation. And sure enough, this thing called GDPR came out. And I read through an early draft of it, and my first thought was, oh my gosh, companies are in so much hot water with this. Because everything that we had been selling them for decades in the, you know, data management, business intelligence, all of the best practices around having backups and redundancy and geographical dispersion of data and making data flow like water, all of a sudden those best practices that have been in place for decades are going to bite companies in the rear because they don't know where their data is, let alone be able to find it all to delete it or tell anybody what they have. And so I started to do a bunch of research, and I talked to about 50 Fortune 500 companies, and I asked them the same 5 questions. Is this a problem? How are you dealing with it? What are the technical challenges to dealing with it? Are you using any technology today, or could you repurpose any technology you know of to solve this problem? And if I found something, would you pay for it? And if so, how much? And across every single industry, the answers were exactly the same. Huge problem, don't know how to deal with it. The technical challenges are that data's everywhere. It's in the cloud, it's on-prem, it's structured, it's unstructured, it's at rest. Now there's this stuff coming out of Facebook and Twitter that's streaming data, data in motion. We have no idea where any of this stuff is. We couldn't tell you what we've got, even if we tried. And so being able to tell you what our risk stature is relative to these regulations that are coming out, no idea. Like, just no idea. And they said, we've never seen any technology that can solve it, don't know of anything. Security technology as it is today doesn't solve it because they help you secure the perimeter and secure the data. They don't actually tell you what it is. And yeah, we would pay a ton. 4% of revenue is terrifying, not to mention brand and reputation risk. The only company that didn't say this is a problem they intended to solve is a social networking company that had to appear before Congress. And that was truly my Schadenfreude moment. They were the only ones that said, not really something we're going to deal with. And maybe, granted, maybe I wasn't talking to the right people. Maybe there were people there who did care. But that was the only company that said no. And so I spent 2 years looking for a company to invest in. And after talking to those 50 companies, I had a pretty good sense of what the software needed to look like, what kind of problems it needed to solve, how it needed to be designed to fit within existing architecture, what kind of feature functionality it needed to have. And I just went scouring. I was here at RSA. I was going to meetups. I was trying to find anything out there that would start to solve this problem. And after 2 years, GDPR passed into law, and there was still no technology. The only thing I could find were basically workflow products that created a pretty UI on what's effectively a spreadsheet where you manually enter information in. And that doesn't actually solve the problem because you've got a bunch of lawyers plugging this information in, consultants plugging this information in, but it's completely disconnected from the data layer. And so after 2 years, GDPR passed into law, I thought, well, I know how to build products. I now know the VC industry. I know the people. I know how fundraising works. And I know what investment criteria needs to look like. And so I put together a pitch, made 2 phone calls to people who I knew. You know, I looked at the VC community and I said, okay, who invests at this stage? Who invests in this sector? And who's somebody I want to be in the foxhole with? And I got down to 2 names. And I called them both. And in 2 weeks, I had a term sheet. And I just said, great, let's go. And it was me in a PowerPoint deck and just went and got on it. And I realized that's a very exceptional story because I come from the VC side, but it actually is illustrative, and we'll come to this later on how do you fundraise in hard economic times. We'll talk about relationships as it pertains to raising money, because that's ultimately what it was. It was cashing in personal equity, like relationship equity, to say, hey, look, this GDPR thing, it's the front of a tidal wave of regulations that's happening. This is going to be a huge market. And the reason companies are struggling to comply with these regulations is there's no data logic layer that ties everything together, that ties together the data map, because nobody knows where their data is, and ties it to all of their obligations as a company, let alone automate the actions. And so that missing layer is a layer in the stack, and that's a category. And so all I had to do was paint that picture, and people were like, okay, good, let's do it. Here's a check, let's go. And so that was my founding story. And so it's a little bit different, but coming at it from a different angle.
So next we want to talk about what makes a valuable company, mm-hmm. right? Like, why are you doing this if you are going to make a very limited value company, right? So I have a few things that, you know, I thought about and, you know, also look back on and said, you know, we kind of lucked into this. You know, we are more valuable because of this. And, you know, one of them is, and, you know, the VCs will talk about this all the time, is your TAM, right? Your total addressable market. Like, how big is your market? And, you know, obviously GDPR is big. It's every company that has, you know, personal data. You know, for us, we saw the market for us as everyone who builds software, right? And, but at the time, which is also obviously a very big market. It's practically every single company is over a certain size is building software. But at the time, you know, the investors and, you know, sort of our competitors, people who could have been competitors, saw the addressable market as people who are required by regulation to do security testing, which was at the time really just financial services. HIPAA really hadn't come around yet to open it up to the healthcare market. So, but we didn't believe that. We believed that our TAM was gonna be everyone building software because we saw that software was just adding risk, and over time, more and more of the market was gonna be required to produce software with less vulnerabilities to exist in their marketplace. So part of it was having a big TAM, but part of it was also believing that our TAM was much bigger than competitors were, which allowed us to not have as many big players, you know, competing with us for the first few years because they just didn't see the big TAM that we saw. So I think that was definitely something. So you know, one of it is like you need a big TAM to make a valuable company, but part of this was having a runway to get ahead of some of the big players that could have competed with us. Another huge thing for a valuable company is customer retention. Like if you look at your churn rate, like if you have a 70% customer retention, you're turning over your customer base a little over every 3 years. That's a lot of new sales that you have to go out and find and go to battle with to get. You know, that's hard. If you get to 80%, you know, customer retention rate, now you're turning over your sales, your customer every 5 years. And if you can get to 90%, you're turning over your customer base every 10 years. So it's exponential, right? Every point you get, once you get up to like 80 and more, is you're just adding a huge amount of value because you don't have to spend all this time and energy landing new customers. The other factor is customer retention is great because, you know, I don't know if you've noticed, but CISOs move around a lot. Security people move around a lot. So, you know, a CISO I once saw like has an average tenure of like 2.5 years or something. So when they move around, if you've made them successful where they were, like you made them the hero. They were successful in their career goals, what they said that they were gonna do to their management, and they move to a new job, they're gonna want you again. So the customer retention can span, if you make your executive sponsor happy, it can span across organizations. So it's, you know, delighting your customers, making your customers happy, but also making them the hero so that they meet their personal goals. And why, you know, why would someone, you know, go somewhere else if you're making them successful in their job? And then finally, I have one other point that was sort of a lesson along the way was, you know, solve more of the customer's problem, right? If you're just solving a piece of the problem, then you have other people that are part of solving that problem for the customer. And so when you look at something like security testing, there's a, you know, an automation aspect to it, but there's also a people aspect to it, whether it's manual testing, certainly, but there's other people aspects to it too. Like there's program management, like who rolls this out and puts policies in place and gets the reporting working, and that's different for every organization. And then, you know, when vulnerabilities are found, you know, who knows how to fix them, right? So figuring out how to augment our automation, which was all SaaS-based, with a layer of services that could help make the customer successfully onboard the technology and then meet their particular goals, and also when we found problems, complete the solution, which is actually fix the vulnerabilities too. Now, don't just tell me what my problems are, help me lower risk, right? Learning that augmenting, you know, automation with some services to complete the problem and not have to rely on service providers who could do a bad job, who are obviously taking away some of the total spend that could be coming to you, was a big lesson learned that kind of accelerated the business and made it more profitable.
That's awesome. That's great. I've got a fairly clinical view of what makes for a valuable company, and that's because of my last role. So for me, it's market, team, technology, and in that order. And as it was described to me when I first started in venture, you could have the most phenomenal team running an airline, but it's still going to be an airline. You know, it's not going to be the rocket ship growth or rocket ship profitability. It's an airline, and that's just the market. Whereas you could have a mediocre team with a mediocre technology in a booming market, and you could end up with a very valuable company at the end of it.
Would cybersecurity be one of those?
Here's hoping. But yeah, so that order of market was number one, was the biggest indicator to me when I was doing research for this company, is that, okay, this could be a huge market. The fact that people don't know where their data is and can't tie it to their obligations, that is massive. And this regulation is one of many. You know, there were already tons and tons of privacy regulations worldwide, but that was the first big one with really big teeth, and more were coming. And so that was where I focused my attention. The second thing that I look for with market, you know, in terms of big and growing markets, is for a technology that defines a new one, very much like what Veracode did. We were early investors in Splunk and Cloudera and DocuSign and a bunch of different companies. And the thing that we found led to billion-dollar exits was a company that defined the market. They got there first. They created the rules. They said, this is what this is. And because they defined the market and maybe took something that was previously manually done and automated it, or grabbed onto brand new technology and became the main vendor, the first vendor, and got out there first. That was the other thing. And so when I was trying to decide, do I leave my cushy job and go take a big risk and start a company, you know, big pay cut, big risk, but also big fun, do I want to do it? And I thought, you know, okay, this is a huge market and it's only going to get bigger. Most people don't know it exists yet, and it's currently done entirely manually with spreadsheets and emails and people checking boxes. And that's, at the best of times, completely inaccurate, because when you've got a petabyte scale data warehouse or Hadoop cluster, there's no way you know what's in it. And so I just thought, this is something where it's very similar to Veracode, where this is manually done, that's not scalable, this is a software world, and you need to automate it. And so that's what I look for, and that's what I grapple towards when I think, okay, what's going to create a valuable company? Automate it in a huge and growing market.
So next we wanted to talk a little bit about, you know, building the team and the culture. That was your middle tier of the valuable company, right? Having a good team. And, you know, I totally agree. I mean, you just can't get there without a strong team. When you look at like two companies playing in the same market space and you start to dig down, like, why is one more successful than the other one? And a lot of it just comes down to they're able to build a stronger team. Like, they were just able to execute better, be more creative, work together. You know, it takes teams to do everything. And, you know, I think we were lucky having that sort of the kernel of a team that we're able to start with. But I think another big part of it was a strong vision. Having a strong vision where someone could come on board and sort of understand what is the team trying to do, and can recruit their friends and colleagues to come that they had worked with, say, you know, this is a great place to work. Well, why? Well, we have great people. Well, why? Because we have this great vision of what we want to accomplish. So I think the vision that's clear, and you know, we wanted to secure all the software that people were building in the world, right? And we wanted to do this in an automated, scalable, easy way. That's a vision that a lot of people in the security field could get behind, but also in the software community. Another way to build a strong team is get people to stay at the company, right? Part of that comes to culture, but part of it also comes with having good managers. Like, the number one reason that people leave a company is they don't like the person they're working for, right? So if you have a manager that people don't like working for, guess what? The people are going to join because they like the vision, they see the culture, and then they don't like working for that person. So being able to hire good managers, but also, you know, train people to be managers internally when someone wants to make that move from an individual contributor, that's a great way to build a strong team, because you got people who stay at the company for 5, 6, 7, 8 years instead of, you know, 2 years. You know, the other part of that is career ladders, like people coming and joining as their first job. If you don't have a place for them to go, then they're going to leave and they're going to go to another company for their next stage. That's hard to do in the early days, but once you get to that scale of, say, you know, 100 people, you can start to do that. You know, for example, like when we have our, you know, business development reps come on straight out of school, you know, dialing the phone and talking to people and trying to set up meetings and all that, well, you know, inside sales is a great next step for those people. And then the step from there could be inside sales manager or, you know, a field salesperson. So they see people go through that path and they want to stay, and you get people to stay at your company for a longer time. And sort of the final note I'd say on building a strong team is, for lack of a better word, you know, get rid of the assholes. You know, there are people that are just poison to the organization. They're like lone wolves. They're out for themselves. They won't work with other people. They could be, they're probably some of your best, you know, most competent people, you know, knowledgeable, good workers. But you have to either talk to them about the way that they're behaving and the way that other people are seeing them and get them on board to change the way they're behaving, and that's possible. Or you have to exit them out, because especially early on, that can be poison to be building the strong team and the right culture, because people just don't want to work with that person, and they won't put in their extra discretionary effort because they're working with this person that they don't like. So I'll just end it there with the team building.
Yeah, I think that's awesome. I just noticed we've got 10 minutes left, and I know we want to leave time for questions. So why don't we jump to spend just a couple minutes on fundraising in a time of economic uncertainty. Yep. And Chris, I know you had some great stories about that. You were fundraising in 2008.
Yeah, we were going for a B round in 2008, which was not ideal. And, you know, since I was new to fundraising, there wasn't really good planning there. And you know, we sort of expected, oh, for our B round, you know, we'll get all the investors to come back in, and maybe we'll get an additional VC to come in to diversify, which is sort of the standard thing you do in a B round. Well, when there's an economic downturn, you have to understand that not every one of your investors is going to be able to come back in pro rata, because they're going to be thinking about, hey, these are the portfolios of all my companies. My fundraising is doing poorly, so I don't have as much money as I expected, so I'm going to have to drop some of my investments, which is a hard thing for a VC to do, because they basically get washed out most of the syndicate terms on the different rounds. So that was difficult, because then we had to convince the two other investors to stay in and pick up the share of the third investor, and we couldn't get any new investors to come in. So, you know, with better planning, maybe having some venture debt available or having a more diversified set of investors, maybe we didn't have any, well, we had one small angel investor, but, you know, a set of angel investors. I think diversity and planning with having some, you know, debt available, could have smoothed it over better. And if I was planning now for the next couple of years, and part of it is also having a little bit longer runway if you expect an economic downturn, those are some of the things I would be planning for now, for the next few years.
I'll just add on just a couple of points to that. When VCs are looking at investments during an economic downturn, they typically don't stop investing because they raise a three-year long fund, and so they can kind of ride the little blips here and there. But what they do is slow down their cadence of investing. So instead of doing maybe eight deals a year, they'll do five or four. And in terms of following on to investments, they'll only look for investments that have got top-tier investors in them, because that's a form of safety. And it's kind of ironic that for a group that takes very risky bets, they're incredibly risk averse. And so who your early stage investors are matters a lot. Whether they're angels or seed investors, if they're high quality and they're known for folks that pick really good deals really early on, that will give you a little bit of buffer for when you're in a situation of economic downturn and you're trying to raise an A or a B or even a C. They'll look at who your prior investors are, and if other really smart people who've been really successful put money into your company and are still backing you, and because you're in the top 50%, then they're going to feel comfortable placing that bet too, because that's a bit of insurance. It's kind of that herd mentality. So I think one of the mistakes people make early on is thinking, oh, taking money from, you know, Uncle Bob and Auntie Sue and this guy who's a executive at a big company and is investing off the side of his desk, and this is the third investment he's done, that's a good idea. And, you know, maybe it is, and maybe it's what you need to do early on. But try to get high quality investors in there as quickly as you possibly can, because that will future proof you in the event of an economic downturn. So at this point, we'd love to get questions from the audience. We've been chatting for a while up here. There's microphones both there and there. And so if you don't mind walking to the microphone to ask your questions, that would be great. And then everybody can hear you. I know we've got one coming.
Hi, good morning, Monica here. I have two questions, one for Chris and one for Kristina. Chris, you mentioned that you stated, you mentioned you started the company with six people, right? Those were like the core people for building the culture and the business.
Yep.
The question would be, how did you find those six people?
So they were part of, I was working with them at the employer that we spun out of. So when we looked at, you know, spinning out, we said, you know, what people do we want to bring along? So it's like, are these people, you know, obviously they need to have a key role where we were going. So it was, we didn't take everyone who was working on the project. It was people that we thought, you know, wanted to go on this journey with us as a startup, and also would help make a strong core team.
So do you find them both from personal and professional relationships that already exist?
So I mean, we were working with them.
Right.
We were working at the same company.
Right.
So we knew them pretty well.
The question for Kristina is: you said that most of your entrepreneur, the story that you said is based on research, right? And you said this was almost 2 years, or maybe more.
Yeah, 2 years.
But I'm guessing you were probably not doing just research in those 2 years. So just to understand the whole workload and what it means to actually build a business, what else were you doing at the same time?
Well, I was also still working full-time as a VC, and
right.
So that research was as a VC.
Right.
And when I couldn't find something to invest in, I just thought, this is such a no-brainer of a market opportunity. I need to leave. Like most people in Europe had already started to discuss the implications at that point, but most people in the US were sitting there saying, GDPR what? And so I thought, this is a great opportunity to get out ahead of it and start building something. And so during that time when I was doing research, I was developing a fairly strong opinion on what that technology needed to look like and what it needed to do. And so that's what I was looking for. There was a specific profile of a company I was looking for. And so when I ruled out some of the workflow tools that just kind of had front-end pretty UIs on a glorified spreadsheet, I just said, no, that's not going to solve the problem, and ruled those out, and still didn't find anything that actually fit the criteria I was looking for what that technology needed to do.
Great, thank you.
Thank you. Great questions. Yep.
Yeah, question on the personalities of the people who are trying to start a company. How important is it to be what I see with yourselves and others who lead companies and start companies, extroverted, gregarious, confident in what their knowledge base and what they already know? How important is that to those relationships and building those relationships and opening those doors?
That's a good idea.
Yeah, I mean, you're going to have to network, right? You're going to have to meet people that aren't like you, right? I mean, you're going to have to hire, you know, a CFO and a head of HR, and you're going to have to be able to network with people. But I think the key thing is risk taking, like willing to, you know, take risks, because you really just don't know how it's gonna go. I mean, for a few years, I had no idea if it was going to be successful or not. You just have to, you know, believe in it and believe in taking that risk. So I see, you know, more than being extroverted or a good networker, I think it's the important thing is I'm not actually particularly extroverted myself, but I see that helps. I think risk, being able to take risks is probably the biggest factor.
Yeah, I would second that one. I'm not extroverted at all either, but I turn it on. You know, you just like flip a switch.
It's part of the job.
Yeah. But, you know, I'm going to go back to my hotel room tonight and, you know, suck my thumb and watch the Golden Girls because I need some downtime. But, you know, not everybody at the company has to be able to be customer facing. You know, everybody's got their relative strengths. And so the thing that I realized early on, I made a big mistake early on. I overclocked for people's IQ and their ability and their hard work, and underclocked on their EQ. And that was to my peril. And I've since corrected that big time. We brought on a head of people. She was our 20th employee, which is really early to have someone in that kind of a role. But it's because I realized I've got a huge blind spot. I'm interviewing for intelligence and competence and ability to get it done. And what I'm missing are all the soft skills, the grease and the skids that make all the teamwork happen. And so we've done a hard correct on that and done a much better job in over the last year of getting that EQ, because you do need a certain base level of it for everything to gel well. And, you know, IQ is not a substitute for EQ. Go ahead.
Okay.
Great.
Thank you. Question around just self-funding versus venture capital. So I'm just curious if you have any thoughts on that. I think, Kristina, you mentioned that you did self-funding at one point or not.
No, I wasn't able to self-fund because I needed a big chunk of money to buy out the technology and the patent to spin out. Like, spin out, it's really difficult to self-fund, so I didn't do any self-funding.
Yeah, I did with my first two companies, but they were not capital intensive. And so it was literally, you know, I was 19 years old when I started my first one, and it was literally tapping into my savings account from birthday money and babysitting money and everything else. And, you know, I was a painting contractor. I had to buy a van and a bunch of paintbrushes. It wasn't capital intensive. For this company, it was capital intensive because we were solving big kid problems and we needed big kid employees. We couldn't just grab a bunch of people who were working for free. We needed people who knew where the bodies were buried in large organizations from a security and infrastructure standpoint. And so that level of sophistication means you're going to be hiring people with a mortgage, with dependents, and you have to be able to pay them a salary. And so we went right out of the gate and raised money, knowing that we would never be able to build the kind of technology we needed to build if we didn't have gray hairs on the team.
My name is Bartosz, and thank you for the great overview of the startup world. I have one particular question about establishing a sustainable sales channel, because as an unknown company in the startup world, you work with big clients, Fortune 500 companies. So how do you sell that? How do you approach them if they never used this product before?
So enterprise sales is hard, and you have to get someone who has those relationships. So like hiring someone who has sold enterprise cybersecurity products before, okay, will you know, maybe has done that at a few companies and has a track record and can call into those companies and say, you know, I sold you this product before or this service before, it, you know, it made you successful. I think this one can do the same thing. But that's pretty important, because if you're going to be selling into those people, you need to be able to open the door and get them to try a pilot or give you feedback, or you're just not really going to go anywhere. So getting someone that's another gray hair salesperson that you're probably going to have to raise money to get if you want to get into enterprise sales.
Two little sneaky guerrilla tactics. Most large organizations have got a venture outreach group, and there's some form of business development whose primary job is to find companies like ours and bring them into the company and help them navigate and find you the right decision makers, find you the right people. And they're metriced on getting those people in. And most large organizations at this point have them. They do spend a lot of time with VCs, but they will also work directly with startups. And so that's one tactic. The other that I also found really helpful was asking people for feedback, because early on, you want feedback, like tons of it. And so reaching out through LinkedIn and saying, hey, I'm starting a company that does XYZ. You look like you've got great experience. I'd love to, can I borrow 30 minutes of your time and get your feedback on this? That's a great way to help you get real feedback on your product. But if there's interest there, they can say, well, actually, I want you to come in and meet these people and present to us. So those are a couple of guerrilla tactics, but we're getting the stop sign up front on time.
Thank you.
But thank you guys very much. Really appreciate you joining us. I hope this was a useful part of your day. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.